Welcome, everybody. As I said, my name is Fiona Murphy. I'm from Cyber Women Ireland, and I also work in Sunlight Financial, and I'm a remote employee. I work for the Security Strategic Initiatives area, delivering global-wide security projects across all various areas of security, collaboration with security engineering teams, investigations, as well as operations teams. And my colleague, Dina.
Hi, everyone. My name is Dina Vyapuri, and I'm the founder of TechFinder. TechFinder is a talent management services company. We do upskilling training and also sourcing talents. I'm also one of the founding members of Cyber Women Ireland, and together we want to bring more women into the sector.
Our agenda today really is talking about trying to give you a bit more insight into what we want to talk about today. So we want to highlight the many faces of cyber, understanding what that cyber landscape looks like today and what are the gaps and needs that are out there and how we can fill those. Looking at any upskilling and learning opportunities for women and adults, and as well as looking at mentoring and sponsorship of women. And as you can see there, there's a number of women on the screen, and these are a number of women that we would are either on the Cyber Women Ireland board or women we would work with in the industry. Today, what we see in the industry is very diverse in regards to the talents that are out there. But however, we don't see it with regards to women, and we know that there is a global shortage and we are trying to attract those women to security. We also know that joining security, what they see out there today, there is big business in security, and there's a lot of big business like that is represented in conferences, represented across webinars, and we want to change what that looks like out there today. Again, as we say, you can often see a number of things called manuals, and this is just people going to your general people that you would go to every day for these kind of webinars. And we want people to kind of change that mindset and think about who they are putting forward for panels in security, or who they are also, I suppose, looking at and how they're representing their employees in work and how they're attracting the talent in work. We see definitely in the younger generation, we see that a lot of them are on Twitter and they're building their profiles there. And we're also seeing women and people in security in general, the younger groups, wanting to work in an area that is collaborative, that they can bring their whole self to work. I think in the security industry, we need to showcase that this is an environment where people can develop their skills, that it's an exciting area to work, but also that we want to see their whole steps coming to work as well.
I actually wanted to ask you, Fiona, in your own opinion, what are the gaps and needs that you actually see within your industry in terms of the cyber landscape?
I suppose with Cyber Women Ireland, Dina, we get to speak to a lot of women and a lot of people in IT security. And I think just from my own review and people I've spoken to, I think people don't realize how many roles there are within information security. I think there's a perception out there that there's only one type of security role out there, and that's the ethical hacker or your pen tester. And for me, like I came from a management role in managing technical help desks and went into security, and I thought, again, you know, just one role. So it was a surprise to me to see how many different roles there were out there. And definitely that we can teach you the technical, but you need to have the certain soft skills as well. So I think a lot of the soft skills that I've seen in security are transferable across, you know, all groups. People in business often look for employees who are collaborative, take the initiative of curiosity. They're all desired skills as well as the technical. So that was a big thing to me and a big revelation to me. So I think we have to do more work on just advertising what kind of roles are out there and putting out different types of role models out there in the environment. I know when I went out there first, I kept seeing the same type of roles being advertised, the same speakers going out there. So I think we need to talk about different topics out there in the environment. Dean, I think another thing is the job descriptions. Reading certain job descriptions, I don't think I would have gone for them previously. And I know in Sunlight, we're doing huge work on trying to revamp the job descriptions that we put out there, remove things like, you know, there's been a lot of work and study on gender bias, or, you know, making sure that our job descriptions are gender neutral, that we are putting out different words around what topics we are, what way we write the job descriptions, and definitely include words around support, encourage, and mentorship to help attract different types of talent. And I think, yeah, I think they're the main kind of gaps, definitely. And it's just trying to attract the talent and having different types of role models out there. We need more. We need to put more people in front of younger students to say, this is what the role models look like. Not everybody wants to be at the C-level suite, and that's great if you do. Or not everyone wants to be the executive. And again, that's great if you do. But how do we put the analysts out there? How do we put the engineers out there? How do we put someone coming in and, you know, someone like in my role doing the delivery aspects, how do we put them out there and showcase, like, this is what people in security look like?
So I totally agree with you that, Fiona, that cybersecurity is incredibly diverse, you know, as we need problem solvers, analysts, leaders, and so on. And they possess all these skills and qualities. And I think there are many ways for women to start a career in cybersecurity. And more than ever, I think the industry has actually acknowledged that there is a gender gap, and or they are implementing different initiatives to encourage more women to consider a career in cybersecurity. And there's a few examples that I can actually comes to mind and I can mention here. For example, TechFinder myself started the Cyber for Women initiative, upskilling, you know, to upskilling migrant women last year, and we are running a pilot at the moment, and that's going really well. Another initiative is actually by Cyber Ireland. They have the Cyber Academy, providing opportunities for 11 to 18 years to explore and build their cybersecurity skills while, you know, in secondary education. And they have successfully run two pilots that I know of, one in Cork and one in Galway, and now they are extending it to other counties as well. And lastly, another one that I wanted to mention actually is the IT at Cork Skillnet. They have an employer activation program, and that I actually personally had the privilege to support this program for also running for migrant women. For any women out there who actually, you know, would like a career change or and get some advice, mentorship, and how to get into this industry, they can actually come to us, Cyber Women Ireland, to actually help them and give them mentorship and help them whatever way we can, and maybe point them to different initiatives that are actually running across Ireland by different companies that is encouraging women to get into cyber.
You know, you've done a lot of work with Cyber for Women and, you know, your new initiative there with supporting migrants. And as well, we have the Cyber Academy.
I think I see there's a lot of demand in terms of people who, whether it's women or even new graduates or, you know, even people coming from different industry that are actually willing to get into cybersecurity. I think the main thing that I see repeatedly, questions I've been asked would have been, I know I want to do it and I think I can do it, but where do I start or how do I go about it? And I think we need more initiative to actually help people who would like to get into cyber and make it a little bit easy for them. And, you know, where do they go to get the information? Who do they talk to? And that's one way I think we will be able to attract more people and cater for the gap that that we have globally.
Okay, yeah. And I know that Cyber Women Ireland did a talk with I Wish there back in the start of the year before all this pandemic broke out, speaking to young students as well, basically encourage them, you know, to look at a career in cyber and see the opportunities that are available to them, and to also discuss the different paths to cyber. You can either, you know, come in through your third level education, or you can use apprenticeship programs, as well as looking at things like, you know, maybe cross-departmental transfers. So that, you know, for example, that's what I did. I went from our managing our service desks over to security architecture, getting trained internally. We need to, I suppose, as well, promote there is free online learning. And I know as well in certain companies, they do give their employees access to learning portals. We have the O'Reilly module. We've used Udemy and things like that previously as well. There is a lot of resources out there. It's just making them available and then people know about those.
And also, I suppose, kind of providing information, how do you go about it? I think there's a lot of resources out there and a lot of free resources out there as well. And Cybery and all the other ones that, you know, you can avail of. But I think For some people, what they find difficult is, well, where do I start first? What do I do first? Do I have to go? I think my latest question someone asked me was, do I have to go and do a master's degree in cybersecurity to get a job within the sector? It's more of awareness, how to get people and where do they mm-hmm. start?
I suppose another way that we do look at how we support women, not just, I suppose, in cyber, but in within organizations or within, you know, groups you may be part of, you know, we, in, for example, if I give you an example, in Sun Life, we do a lot of mentorship and sponsorship of women. And I have found that myself very beneficial. And I think that others who have used it as well have found that extremely beneficial as well. And I'm not sure if certain people know what the difference is. Your mentors really are those people who you go to for advice, feedback, coaching, you know, how to maneuver around maybe company politics, how to, you know, they give you tips and strategies. And they can be really important in your career, especially if you're starting off and you're new to cyber. It is very important, you know, to have someone that, like, to reach out to someone. And I'd recommend that you reach out to someone who is slightly, you know, who thinks it's slightly different to you. That's something that I would recommend, so you can get a different perspective. And sponsors, they promote you. They may not be your direct leaders. They mightn't be in your department, or they may be in your online communities. They're people who call each other out. They promote them. They help them advance. And when you combine both mentorship and sponsorship, you can have a very strong employee, one that becomes more confident in what they're doing. They know how to navigate the workplace, and it does provide growth opportunities for those folks as well. One of the examples I'd give you is our Sun Life Horizon program in the company that I work for. We collaborate with Waterford Institute of Technology. The program is basically supporting girls in IT to show them what our IT workplace looks like, to show them what IT people are like, both male and female. So we have male and female mentors, and also to get them to come in. So we, out of that group there, we had four students who were studying cyber and forensics, and we gave them shadow sessions, on-the-job shadow sessions, and basically they saw what it was like from the investigations teams, what it was like from the access governance teams. From my own, at the time, it would have been architecture and now project delivery. They would have seen all that, and they would have had exposure to things like the advisory team. I think when they see it in real life, the things that they're being taught in college is helping that to make more sense. You see them, they're more motivated to go forward. They're curious as well. They do go forward then and put their CVs forward for internships. It builds a connection to the company. And we have found that to be very beneficial. Some of the feedback they've given has been, you know, even just coming in going, how do I interview? What are they going to ask me? Are they going to try to trick me out? Are employees wanting me to protect the entire environment? You have these really scary thoughts going through their heads, when in fact you know that your career path is something that you develop over time, and there's development and there's, you know, support and skill building throughout your career. So no one expects you to implement a brand new IDS system and manage it by yourself. You know, you're going to get that support, and that's what they found. And they also found that they thought the world of security was a job where you were an individual contributor, you worked on your own all the time, but they got the opportunity to see that actually we collaborate quite a lot with each other across different departments, across different countries. You know, it's not just that single job, especially when, you know, you're investigating something, you might need different areas. And, you know, in our organization, security sees all parts of the organization. You have to interact with, you know, your global HR teams, your global privacy teams, your legal teams, and all the different various business units. So I think that was a great eye-opener for them. And as mentees, we would have given them opportunities to do things like mock interviews. We would have given them presentation skills given them opportunity to present something, a topic that they would have, you know, liked to discuss. So that I think that's been a very successful program. It's just finished its year this year. I think another thing that we do is sponsorship. And I think that's very important for the women in industry. Having a leader call you out and, you know, be in an email saying, you know, recognizing you for the work you've done. Or I think I saw something before where I said a mentor would say, you know, for example, have you gone out and you should go out and look to do conferences, where a sponsor will go, I've put your name forward for someone who'd be great to speak at this event. You know, it's saying, I'm putting you forward. And I think that's what people need to do in the industry. And I've seen it from, I suppose, from our leaders. I've seen it on social media. And I've seen, you know, some people are very good at it. And it does help you get that step up the ladder, definitely the sponsorship side of things. Go out there. And if there's people in your company that, you know, you're thinking, God, am I putting the same people forward for the same projects or the same work all the time? Do I need to think about that? Do I need to call out someone? We never put them forward because we go to the same people all the time. Like, think about those kind of things, because you will get that back from them. When you invest in your people, you get it back tenfold. And people see that. You're not just, you know, you're not just talking the talk, you're walking it. If you want to change and get more women in the industry, I think you need to do things like this. And I think you need to be absolutely serious about it, from your job descriptions to your code of conducts to your board level. We have that in Sun Life across the board. Bring your whole self to work. We have different committees for women leadership, for pride groups. You need to be able to bring your whole self to work. And that's what people want to see in an environment, that they'll be supported in that. So I would recommend that people go out there, and if you're serious about making changes, go out there and look at what you're doing today and see, do you need to mentor anyone? Do you need to sponsor people? And see if that provides you any benefits as well.
I totally agree with you there with the sponsoring other women. Because I think it's very easy to go to the same person because you know that they're going to, you know, they're probably that person or more comfortable in speaking or kind of more open. Whereas it's also sometimes when you approach someone, they might not be comfortable and they'll say no. You might ask the other person because they are used to do it. And I think there's a little bit of, we take the easy way out sometimes. Even if someone says no, you try and help them and encourage them and try to get them, you know, to take the first step. But once you've done it once and twice, you kind of, you know, you get better at it and you can actually continue. And then and like that, you build the person each time that you actually encourage them. And maybe even offer mentorship in public speaking or get them any mentors that they need to actually boost their confidence a little bit, I think will go a long way as well.
100%, yeah. I think I've seen definitely, you know, CISOs who've called out people in projects or in investigations, and they've called out the analysts and they've called out people in, you know, the business areas or people who's definitely helped in that, who are not just the leaders. And that's really seen such great motivation from that. That really gives someone a bit of confidence. They'll want to do more. They'll want to learn more. They'll become hungry for it. So I think that's important. And especially women, yeah. I think next time you're putting someone forward for a project or next time you're looking at a role, just check yourself and say, am I putting the same people forward? We talk about unconscious bias. Have I got an unconscious bias? Am I looking at that when I'm interviewing them? Should I look at this differently? Should I do a bit more research on this? We hear a lot of feedback from women in the industry talking about, you know, when they're talking to recruiters, sometimes people saying, oh, women don't sell themselves in interviews. Maybe you need to be looking at it a bit differently. Maybe you need to look at, is there an unconscious bias there? Is there something you're not doing in your job descriptions? There's all that kind of information.
I totally agree with you on the women doesn't like it. Well, not all women like to sell themselves. Like, I would be like that as well. Sometimes I'll take the, if you ask me to introduce myself and tell what I do, I'll take the shorter version of what I do. And it's something that, you know, for me, it's not that easy to talk about myself, whereas I can actually talk about other people more and I'll, you know, promote other people better than would actually promote myself. And maybe I need to do some work on myself.
That's perfect, Dina. Thanks for that. That's good. Thanks for being so honest. That's our talk today. We'll open it for some Q&A. What is the biggest challenge encouraging females into security roles?
Yeah, I actually think that a lot of women think there's this perception of the roles within cybersecurity are technical and, or mostly technical, and that will, you know, make it difficult for women if they don't feel they are technical enough to get into these type of roles, I think, in my opinion, one that keep coming all the time.
There's been I suppose I've looked at this from an IT area and a cybersecurity area. It's always been a struggle to try and encourage women into IT. And it's trying to define what that is. I gave a talk in WIT to transition year students, and I asked, you know, the group of students, how many of you think you're technical? And I got a big show of hands from the lads. And then I said, how many of you, you know, fix your roofers at home for your family? And how many fix the, you know, the phone for your parents and things? And the hands went up and it was much more balanced. And I was like, you know, like if you're fixing a router at home or the Wi-Fi at home for someone, that's troubleshooting, that's problem solving, that's IT, that's the beginning of it. You know, you need to get in the door. And it's just changing people's perception of it is a big thing. And I think it is we need to get in there to the younger groups and start there with regards, are we lacking female role models? There's another question there. And I think that's a big thing as well, especially in cyber. The women I can think of who are out there representing are, some of them are at a very high level and they're really successful and they're doing an awesome job. But I think we need everyday role models and people that can talk about their roles to more students across their, you know, attending events, saying, I'm an analyst, this is a day in my life, this is what I do, this is where what I work with. I work with people across the globe, I investigate this, or, you know, I work in, you know, for example, Garda Forensics, you know, that could be something, you know, that could be really attractive to someone or exciting. I work with cyber companies across the globe or cyber bodies or governmental bodies across the board. Some that might sound, you know, an exciting to younger people. You know, there can be a lot of travel. There could be, you know, a lot of training as well. And I think that's something that we need to do is not just make this maybe one role or one type of representative there. I do think we need more people out there. And that's what we're trying to do in Cyber Women Ireland, is put more people out there to promote them in, you know, in our social feeds and things like that. So.
And more have a variety of role models that actually, you know, will align with all the different generations. And you know, like you mentioned, the younger ones, the one that's transitioning, and just have them telling their stories and how did they do it and how did, you know, how it all started. And I think that will encourage more women into the sector.
Definitely. Yeah. So you can sign up to Cyber Women Ireland. You can follow us on LinkedIn, or where we're most active is on Twitter. We'll be releasing our new committee members later this week. So you can see those are, so that'll be exciting. Do you think remote internships could be a thing and whether that might be a good route to attract more people into cyber?
I think any ways that we can encourage, you know, encourage people to get into the industry would be good. And a remote could be a good way as well. I think a remote internship, because that will also open opportunities to, you know, individuals all across, you know, the country. And they don't have to be like yourself, Fiona, you work remotely and, you know, and that's working for you. And that will, I suppose, give people the option to actually, they don't have to travel to a different location and things like that to find, you know, work with cyber.
I agree, Dina. I think the world's a different place now.
I think so.
You know, I had to fight for my, I had to fight for my, you know, my remote work because we had the technology. We had, you know, the ability. I saw that I could work anywhere. And because my teams were spread across multiple locations, you know, it in the end, I think it was that, you know, they realized that, yeah, actually you can. And I'm very lucky that, you know, I'm trusted, that my managers give me space and things like that. So I think remote is going to become the norm. So I think internship learning, remote learning can be the norm. I think there's a lot of that going on at the moment. So some good opportunities there. Do you think that we should do more highlighting the variety of roles in security and that are not all purely technical? Yes, I know Sunlife did a, they contributed to a paper in Canada with Accenture, with a number of the financial firms. And they, through all that research, they did kind of advise that the roles will change. They'll be looking more for the advisors. And the strategists going down the line as technology evolves as well. We are seeing a lot more automation in tools, a lot of more machine learning. SOCs don't have time to go through hundreds and hundreds of tickets. You know, you talk about the exhaustion of looking through hundreds of tickets, hundreds of logs. we need tools out there now that make the analyst's jobs easier. I think people will be focused more so on let's see how we can be, rather than means trying to firefight all the time, they're now looking at strategy and how to move forward and how to advise businesses moving forward. Do you think incident response management will be more difficult due to remote working? Well, we have the tools in our environment and we have our team. I join the operations teams forums. So every day we review, you know, what's going through the media, what's happening, how do we respond to it? As I said, we're a global organization. If you have the technology, if you have, you know, the soft phones, the instant messenger groups and things like that, however you want to do it. As I said, as a global company, we're based all over the world. So when we come together, we use things like Zoom. That'll be very important for incident management. Our teams, our global investigation teams, they use the same tools. From that perspective, I think once you set your employees up to work remotely and use Zoom, I think, you know, you should still be able to succeed.
I think if you do have a strategy and a process in place, it should, you know, you would be able to kind of manage. And that also, I think the whole thing about remote working is like, with the what happened recently, I think every company are actually looking at, relook at their strategy and everything that they have in place and how will they manage going forward. And I think in a positive way, I think it kind of gave everyone a little shake up.
Yeah, no, I think so too. And I think we do have to find a kind of a blended approach because not everybody likes the work from home. I may be the advocate for it, or I think some people might, you know, and there are times I do like to go, you know, before this, I used to go back to the office maybe once a month. And that is the connecting in, keeping that relationship going with people across the org. I find that is beneficial. But I can imagine some people may not like that. So I think a blended approach is important. And I think that the way we work will change. And I think the way we work in the office potentially will change as well.
Definitely. And so, I think in my own opinion, I actually think that flexible working will prevail.
Oh, it needs to be. Definitely. It needs to be. Yeah. There's a lot of people at home with their kids and, you know, and it's, you need to be accepting of that. There's men and women joining our meetings and you hear the children in the background, and that's going to become normal because there's nothing anyone can do. I talk to people from Asia to North America every day and I hear the same story. It's the same story. So.
Yeah.
And companies need to be fair to their employees. They need to make sure that they understand that. And, you know, this talk about as well, maybe people going as they are working from home, are they more efficient working from home? Because sometimes it could creep up that you could be, you know, working later hours just because you're at home and it's accessible. You need to be careful of that. But some people are looking at, do you introduce the 4-day work week with the same pay because you're still as productive? It depends. It depends. So should we start educating the next generations earlier, maybe at primary level?
I think definitely on the cybersecurity awareness is something we could introduce earlier at the primary level. That can kind of, they start thinking about it because, you know, this is the generation at this level. If you can implement like cyber hygiene and awareness, I mean, it will make them better in terms of conscious about cybersecurity in general as they grow.
Yeah.
And that's in my opinion. Definitely if we started a bit earlier, that would be good, especially in the, you know, in terms of awareness and things like that.
Like Louise O'Hagan, who is on the Cyber Women Ireland board, she works for CyberSafe and, you know, they do great work. And Cyber Ireland actually had a talk last week with I think it was Avril Ronan was on as well. And they spoke about all the great work that they do with regards awareness for children and schools. And that, I think that's a fantastic initiative. And I do think there's a lot that we need to do with younger people. I always say that being safe online, we need something for our kids that is like the safe passcode version for us when we were younger learning to cross the road. we need something similar and simple for kids, because our online presence is, you know, huge, especially now it's after increasing with the whole pandemic. And we need people to be more aware and savvy, and we need kids to be more aware and savvy as well when they're online. You know, the world has changed very, very quickly. What are the best entry-level positions to apply for people with little prior experience working in the cybersecurity field? I think there's a number of opportunities where you can go into if you want to learn about an org. We take a lot of people from the service desks areas, and this is a great, it's a great entry level to IT, as well as learning about organizations, but it's a great stepping stone into cyber, going into things like access governance. You see our, you know, our access control teams, we have people who come from, let's say they take the route of service, technical service desk, then they go to access governance, and then they would go into the labs, say for example, for ops or investigations, they develop up that way. I suppose maybe an internship if you're in college, definitely apply for those. Look for work experience if you can. I interviewed a young chap in, he was doing the Science Foundation Ireland. It was a competition last year, and I was interviewing for him for, you know, he's whatever he presented. And I was like, you know, he was really interested in the website. And I said, oh, how did you protect it? And he was, you know, strumming off these kind of these things that he was doing, and I was like, this guy's only about 15, oh my god, he's, you know, he's really amazing. And he said he had asked his local security company for work experience, and mm-hmm. I was like, that's amazing. So he was doing that for the summer, like, so that was, you know, you can do different things like that. I know there's other work that I think FIT do as well, where you can study and you can, they work with companies to get you into the company. I've used them before in the help desk, but I know they've got great programs there.
Yeah, there's definitely different upskilling program, you know, as well that you can join, that will, you know, especially on the SOC side of things, that you could, one that I'm kind of running as well is where, you know, you take the aptitude test that it kind of gives you, you know, a report where you can actually see, you know, what level the person is at, and then you can actually recommend different courses that they can upskill into. Mm-hmm. So you could actually, you know, get into SOC level one, or you can get trained for, you know, a pen tester, or, you know, it depends on what the person is actually looking to get into as well. And those would be normally kind of the entry point. And also I see help desk and service desk would normally be the entry point as well, where you get to kind of learn on the job as well, you know, and then you progress within the company. And that's how you're going to find out as well, what do you like and you don't like, and what interests you more. And that's where you go and you develop further as you get more curious and get more mm-hmm. confident, I think.
Yeah, I'd agree. Yeah. And I think as well, it's probably non-traditional way, but I think hugely, and this goes back to the sponsorship and mentorship, but if you do join any of the groups, you know, like things like, you know, CorkSec or, you know, Cyber Women Ireland, building a network, it can be hugely important, because people can give you insight into what it's like working in a certain role. And you can feel more comfortable asking questions to maybe someone you've built a network with or a relationship with in those networks, you know, and they can talk you through those roles. So you don't know what's out there unless you talk to those people, or you build a network, or you find out a bit more about those roles and go, gosh, I never thought of going for that. I was only trying to go in the technical route. I could also go in this, you know, a different route. I could go into advisory. I could go into, you know, in whatever route you wanted to go in. But I definitely say build your connections as well with different groups out there. There's always meetups. Reach out to us in Cyber Women Ireland if you are interested in. I know some groups do returnships as well.
Yeah, I think on Facebook there's another group called Breaking Into InfoSec, I think they're called. And
yeah, on Facebook, yeah, they're very
Facebook,
good.
Yeah, they're very good as well. And they're actually very interactive, and they're really helpful. So if anyone wanna hear is you know, they could check the different groups around as well.
So with the rush to online e-commerce, have you any observations for a company new to network cybersecurity? So, David, I think in where I work, we have a long established team, but that grew from about three people in Ireland to well into about between 25 and 30 people. So we were established a while. I think just from people that I have that are in my life that have their own businesses, it was like, oh gosh, how do I move really quickly into an online presence? And I think it was moving. It was just, I need to get online quickly was the thing. And I think security would have been a background thought. And it's trying to teach them to think about that. But I suppose myself, I don't have any from a provider background.
Just from my talking to different, different companies around or different small organizations, I would say they just find it. They found it difficult just to know, where to go and what to do and how do they implement things. But I think, they just need support and advice on how to go about it.
Yeah, I know a lot of people weren't sure as well about doing online conferencing, things like, like with regard to Zoom, because Zoom, that went from, was it 30 million to over, quadruple. It went really quickly anyway. And they, there was some security concerns around Zoom, but they had to respond really quickly to that. And there was concerns in corporations who use Zoom. We use Zoom, and I think, we make sure that our employees are updating to the latest version of Zoom. We check it, we report on it, and, we make sure that, we look for updates on things like about what's happening with Zoom. I think Cyber Ireland as well put out some information on that. I think Joanne O'Connor had also posted stuff on Zoom on Twitter as well. So
I think the last thing that happened, I don't know, recently, if you knew about it, was where they're hijacking the webinars.
Yeah,
I think that's
a
new thing. So yeah. Well,
just in making people more aware of the settings, having waiting rooms, having, passwords and things like that. We have, in Cyber Women Ireland, we'd love you to follow us. We'd love to help any organizations that are struggling to get a bit of diversity in their organization. Or if you're struggling with regards to how do I become an effective sponsor or how to become a mentor. We are more than happy to help. Reach out to us on Twitter or LinkedIn. We have people from a number of backgrounds, from recruitment, from learning and development, from the engineering teams and the investigations teams, and our new committee as well. We have a huge skill set there as well after joining us. So, do reach out to us. We want to show you that there are benefits to having a diverse workforce. And if you are really serious about changing that, please do get in contact if you have any questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this webinar, please follow us on Twitter and LinkedIn to be kept up to date with all our news, events and programs. You can also subscribe to our YouTube channel for more videos like this one.